Good morning, hackers. Welcome to day two of the Hack HPC at ATME23 Hackathon. This morning, we'll actually be having a very special guest, Ollie, that will actually tell us a little bit about UI and UX using his expertise in the field coming from Purdue. We'll hear from him in a moment, as well as then we'll be followed by our team goals, where our teams will actually go through and let us know what their plans are and at least five tasks for those goals on listing how they're going to accomplish them. But without further ado, I'd like to hand the floor over to Ollie to provide his deep insights on UX and UI. Ollie, the floor is yours.
Thanks again for having me. UX and UI usually takes a lot of time. That's why people like us exist. I created a Google Doc with some resources that you can use fairly quickly. I shared them in the chat. Basically, how could you think about UX for your project is in terms of five W's, what they call them. So who, what, when, where, and why. So who are going to be the people that are going to use your project? Basically the main users. What will they be doing in terms of tasks? What you want them to do? When are they be doing those? Are they doing those in a hurry, or are they doing those every day? Is it something that you want them to do maybe once a month? So stuff like that. Where are they doing those? So that also depends. Are they doing that at home at their, in their comfort zone, or on the job with on a team with multiple people, or are they doing those alone? And I guess lastly, why? What sort of goals are your potential users wanting to accomplish? And another quick sort of mindset you can have is about usability. So basically, how easy it is to use your product. And you can think of that in terms of these five dimensions that you have that you see here and are in the Google Doc as well, which are learnability, efficiency, memorability, errors, and satisfaction. And learnability is how easy it is to accomplish those tasks. Efficiency is how quickly someone can perform once they know the product a bit better. Memorability is how easy for users to come back to the product and be able to do what they did. Maybe they use their product today, and in a couple of months they open it up again, and how easy it is for them to basically remember what they did and how they did it. Errors is pretty self-explanatory. How easy it is to recover from errors, how many errors are there, what happens when people make errors, stuff like that. And lastly, satisfaction, also a pretty important one, how pleasant it is to use your system. But lots of these are accomplished through testing, which I was told that you don't really have time for that or don't have access to the users, but these are still some of the things that you can think about even without the users. That's pretty much it. I'm very happy to answer any questions that you have right now or afterwards. Thanks again.
There we go. Now I'm talking. Let me see if I can turn them on. Thank you so much, Ollie. So here's the deal. And Ollie, I'm sure you're going to be smiling when I say this. So many, I'm speaking in terms of my fellow technical people. A lot of times we just want to make stuff work, you know? We have a task, we get the task accomplished, and sometimes we don't really think about or consider how it looks or how the end user experience affects people. You having focused on UI UX, were you once that way as well? Or did you slowly kind of transition over? Or have you always been a person that was like, I want it to work, but I want to make sure the users have a good experience more? I guess, how did you get into being so focused on it?
I actually have a developer background as well. So I was just like that. And I took one UX course and when I was a bachelor, in my bachelor. And I guess I just started it from there. And I did my master's and, you know, focused on that. So I totally get it. I totally understand. It just takes a lot of practice, I think, you know, to constantly remind you and basically there's always something new in this area. I guess that's why we always test with people, even when you are so to speak more knowledgeable and you like know all these things, you can still make mistakes. It's okay. And I think it's just good to have a bit of a different mindset to just remember about these things.
Excellent. I did have another question for you. So again, we're dealing with students that are all across their careers. You heard, you have some freshmen, you have some seniors, they're just in all throughout master's students and things like that. But that doesn't necessarily mean that they're accustomed to having to have to redesign a portal. I know a few experiences with Paul working with NanoHub and things like that. You all had a huge customer base where, you know, one color change, one adjustment could affect thousands of users, and you're going to hear about it. We won't necessarily have that feedback. So having said that, as they are kind of preparing to design the layout of their new portals, of their new views of these portals, are there any tools that you would suggest that they use and maybe some tips to make sure they don't necessarily go running to jump off the cliff?
Tools in terms of like software or?
Yes, well, in terms of software and or design itself. In other words, because they're working as a group, to make sure that the UX is in mind as they're designing both separately and yet collaboratively, and or tips. In other words, again, I am not a UI UX person, so I'm asking in a very general way. Help us not take false steps if possible.
Yeah, okay. So there's a software, I just shared it in the chat. You can use it. It should be free. It was free a while ago, at least. You can use it to you know, design briefly your layout. It's fairly easy to use. In terms of tips, this is a bit hard because it depends a lot on your project. In the Google Doc that I shared, there's some resources that have you know, sort of general tips for different kinds of you know, UI elements, especially the first two. Those are Twitter threads from experts, and they have some pretty pretty good tips there. You can check those out. But I mean, there's so many of them, and it really depends on your project. I can't really give you, I guess, any general sort of advice, so to speak.
Okay. I think Figma is going to be a big help. That the click and drag design, does Figma actually kick out any code, or this is strictly
just it should be? They had a feature that you can export as CSS, I believe.
Ooh, so you mean it takes care of the grid layouts and all that good stuff that drives me crazy?
It should be. I just haven't used it in a while, but last time I did, they had that feature.
Okay. So I have one other question for you, and then I'm of course open the floor up. I'm priming the pump, so to speak. So is there an example, carefully saying this, I'm going to carefully say this. Whenever people are like, show me an example of what not to do, that we could kind of look to and see if we're doing some of those things that, you know, we don't. In other words, show me the ugliest page that you consider. You're like, whenever you're just, when you are sitting at the, I'm going to say it this way, when you're sitting at the restaurant with your friends and you've had some spirits and you're like, this is what I'm talking about, that this is a horrible design. What is there? Do you have an example of that?
Not at the top of my head, but I guess it's all what I usually like to say to those type of questions. It usually is a in this field, I guess they like to say it depends. The ugliest design you could probably think of is the Craigslist, right?
I was actually going to say that Craigslist comes to mind.
Yeah, but it serves a purpose pretty well, and there's not much alternative, and it generates a lot of revenue. Yeah, so you would think it's even if it's ugly, it accomplishes what it's supposed to. So maybe it's a good thing.
To let our students know, if you were to design Craigslist, what would you do differently?
Good question.
That's a good question. Well,
let me give you a second to think here.
Yeah.
So in the world where Craig goes, I heard about Ollie. I know this dude is amazing, and I'm sick of people joking on my site. I'm going to give him $5 million, $1 million per year for a 5-year contract to make this site not only function well, but also be both eye-catching and pleasing for the user.
Okay.
Remember, $5 million is on the line.
Yeah, this this needs a bit more time, obviously, to research and everything. But some of the things that you can see is there's no proper hierarchy, really. So like everything, the community housing, everything, you can see the insights right away. It's all clumped up. Then if you go back to the main page, usually this the stuff on the left below the calendar, in terms of use, privacy policy, and everything, usually that's in the bottom, somewhere hidden, the about page and everything. I guess, you have some of this stuff right there as well. Yeah. So it's a bit of the search usually also goes to the top right corner. So it's a bit of a more of a, what's the word, placement and hierarchy issue. I also just personally don't like how links are showed by default, mm-hmm. with this blue color, but that's just more of a personal thing.
No, a personal thing's good. That's why you're in your job that you do, because you have these personal insights on some sites like this. So your personal information is very important, or your personal opinion is very important.
You know what bothers me? And I never noticed it before. Everything's lowercase.
Yeah.
Like everything is.
Craigslist, yeah, even the name Craigslist and my account and creating a post, everything's lowercase because it's all, the target audience was such a bare minimal. It's like back in the days of Internet Gopher is what Craigslist was targeting. You know, the old threaded news groups, things like that, and the Linux, Unix command line people. But what they stepped away from is like the event calendar on the left. Nobody ever uses that. I've never heard a thing about this event calendar. You know,
Let's see here. On Saturday, there's this OSHA training, there's safety training, some dog training classes, sewing class for kids.
I've never gone there ever. So that there's no.
Hey, there's a full stack development boot camp.
And here's the other thing I don't like. Like, look at this. Look at the way this page is developed. You see that left column, right? Now go back to the main page. See, the left column moves over all of a sudden. It's not consistent from page to page. So if you're going to have a column like that, make it stay all the way across.
So then, So I challenge you one more time, Ollie. So Craigslist sure. is full of links and a lot of information. And please, oh, please don't let there be anything bad here when I go this time. I'm crossing my fingers that the demo.
Oh, we've all been to Reddit and actually gone to, oh my God, where the heck am I?
Yeah, so we're gonna see what happens here.
It's a risky move. Just get
my okay. Yeah. Okay. All right. We're okay. Okay. So to me, Reddit, and I could be wrong here, but Reddit is similar in that you have tons of stories, tons of links and things like this. And Reddit has evolved over the years because Reddit used to be basically like an RSS site.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So looking at the way that they have adjusted their site from what Reddit used to be, what would you say? Would you say that this is a better way to handle this?
I mean, for this type of content, probably, yeah, it's a bit more organized for sure. Reddit is more or less nice. The only problem I have with them is their video player has never works.
Okay. sounds like that. I agree. I also noticed that because now I'm gonna look for this from now on, the search bar is up top.
Yeah.
And you were saying down at the bottom, which I don't even know if you can get to the bottom. No, they move it over to the right.
So yeah, I guess they have the infinite scroll, so that makes sense.
It's Reddit. We're adults. That's why we make sure people are 18 and older. We can... So
that man was angry.
So you're saying, considering this almost an infinite scroll, having the footer information over on the right hand side and the sidebar kind of makes more sense here, but yeah. It's still better than being over in the left.
Yeah. Well, I think it makes more sense to be on the right.
All right, I got one last one for you, Ollie.
Sure.
One last one.
Google.
No. We're going to go.
I don't know. I have issues with Google Drive. Thank you. So.
Okay.
Oh, no. Should I
go that route?
Yeah. So at least the students can see what Ollie has been involved in.
I've actually haven't been involved in this. I got hired recently.
Okay. Is there an example of a site that you have created that you can show the students? That, hey, this is what I designed and my thought process that went into it.
We know you're an artist. And you're
there was one, but it was a while ago. I mean, I've done a lot of this work many years ago. I'm more of a researcher now.
I see.
So so either they you know don't exist or they got changed a lot. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Okay.
That's that's what happens basically, I guess.
Yeah, that's true.
Is there one that you've used recently? So we've given them bad examples, we're giving them kind of medium examples. Is there one that you would suggest is a good example?
As a good example, let's see.
Well, obviously tax website.
Well, we have redesigned.
We have an updated website. So.
This looks nice, yeah. The search is right there at the top right corner, or where it's supposed to be.
I'm going to remember that from now on. That's going to be one of those things. Ollie says.
Well, no, seriously. If you look at most modern websites, that's where the search belongs. That's where everybody expects to see it.
Yeah, it's about consistency. Basically, if you are looking for search, you expect it to be right there.
It's you.
Yeah.
It's us.
Who are those people? They're nerd.
And because, all right, so Elijah in here? I don't see Elijah. So we have to do ORNL as well. ORNL.gov.
Yeah.
Okay. Have to be fair. All right. What about that?
Ready.
I do like.
Is it just a one page? No, you scroll through. No. It looks.
Yeah,
looks
nice. Yeah. Sometimes issues with the video background. It can. It might take some time to load if you're on bad internet. Or our mobile.
Yeah. Oh, I do like that. That's cool.
Yeah, this is nice.
All right. So I want to open the floor. Thanks, Ollie.
Sorry, I'm laughing a little bit above that. It said, hear our voices. So when you just click on it, do they just go, just listen to their voice. What does this person sound like? Click.
So for our students here, I do want to make sure, like, we're asking questions and things, but I do want to make sure our students, you all are designing portals, redesigning components and things. You all have had time to create your goals. Are there any questions that you'd like to ask Ollie while he's here? He is a valuable resource, so I highly suggest you take advantage of him while he's here. In a good way.
Yeah, you can email me as well if you want to share my email.
Yes. Actually, I think we will drop it not just in this. Well, yes, actually, if you'll type it in chat and we'll add it to Slack as well. So they'll have it even after this is gone. Oh, we do have a hand. So Keyshawn.
Hello, hello. You can hear?
Yes.
Yes.
Can hear
yes.
You.
Yeah.
So I have a. I'm picking from a list of questions that I have. I have a question. So when making a website, I'm curious about what would be, I'm gonna put it like this. Since we're more new to making websites, I'm curious about what you would think is we might miss when making a website, something that's like unintuitive to us, but intuitive to you. So,
okay, that's a bit of a hard question. I guess without knowing more about the project and I'm not sure I can answer that question, sorry.
All right, that's okay. I have one more question.
Sure.
So all right, I'm gonna read it word for word. What's like a good bread and butter philosophy for making a website? Like, what's something like a website should always have no matter what it is? Because I'm pretty sure as everything is a website, there must be like a common element that keeps them, that allows them to serve their purpose. Do you have any idea of what that those could be? Like the bread and butter combos for websites?
Yeah. So again, I guess it depends, but for more complex websites, I usually judge them by their About Me page. I think that one is pretty important. So like just information about them. But I mean, for more simpler ones, well, I guess the search function also is pretty important. I mean, implementing good search functionality is very hard. So I guess if they have that, that's great. But otherwise, like the top menu usually tells you a lot for more simpler ones. And I mean, everyone really judges the website by its landing page, right? So that first sort of screen, the first the top bar and the image, the words that you have are really important. Making sure you know you have stuff in the right place, where your eyes can notice them, like that search thing at the top right corner. So you don't want to have like you know your menu at the bottom, your search like somewhere on the second page, stuff like that. So it's more about keeping it consistent and having the visual hierarchy, stuff like that.
Thank you very much. That's all I got.
Go ahead, Al.
Hey, good morning, Ali. I probably took user interface classes in the 1800s, but back then, I remember a concept of maximum number of elements on a screen being 7. That's the one thing I took away from the class. I took some other things, but that stuck with me. But I'm sure that has modernized. What's the max now? Is there a max? Certainly Craigslist had more than 7 items.
For sure did, yeah. I honestly can't remember if they ever told us anything like that. For having a maximum number. So yes.
The notion was is more too much information confuses the viewer, and confusion leads to people saying, okay, I'm moving on.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I'm not sure. I don't know any number personally, like a go-to number having stuff in your page. I hate to say it, but I in this field, a lot of it depends, because I mean, even with the Craigslist, you have so much information that they're you know, they're printing money, so they're successful. So there's, you know, it's fairly flexible. You can break some stuff as long as it makes sense.
I'm going to give you all one size to work as a web developer and a web application developer as well. And one of the main things that I've always been squeezed into my head, and something we were interested in at the company I used to work for, was something called bounce rate. Okay, that's the number of times that a person goes to your website, doesn't find what they're looking for, and then leaves and goes to another website. Therefore, you lost business. Our rule of thumb was that the company was 3 clicks. The user should have 3 clicks to get to the information they're looking for. If it's vital information that a student wants, it should be 1 or 2 clicks or 0 clicks. For example, you know, if it's something that I'm just going to pull this out of my head, if it's McDonald's, right, and they have a new hamburger that they want to have everybody buy, well, on the web page, that should be the first thing that they're trying to push. It's like, hey, go try our new burger or whatever. If it's a breaking news story, then on a news site, that should be the first hit that you get. So you kind of have to understand what your site is and what it's trying to promote, and then see if what you're trying to promote is why the users are there to begin with. Because the flip side is, not every, maybe a majority of users aren't going to McDonald's website to see the brand new burger. They just want to know where the closest McDonald's is to them. So you have to kind of understand, and that's where the, as Ollie was saying, that's where that research comes into play at. That's where the, what am I after? What am I trying to do? You know, the three W's that he mentioned, because that all comes into play on designing the perfect website. But it's also like, you know, Ollie was saying, it's the user experience. The user doesn't have a nice experience when they come visit you, they're not going to stick around.
You know, Charlie, now that you mention that, when I think about it, out of my 44 years of life, I don't think I have ever one single time gone to the McDonald's website.
Neither have I. You know, the only time I've gone to the McDonald's website was, so I used to teach a class over at our community college on at web application development, right? And the only time I went to McDonald's website was in the Wayback Machine to show them what it looked like way back in the day, and then what it looks like now.
What it looked like, I feel like day. You've got to be in a dark place in your life to go and visit the McDonald's website.
I have gotten a McDonald's record in the newspaper and not been to the McDonald's website. It was a contest, you know, or like played the song. I'm showing my age.
Oh, you're talking about one of those old vinyl pieces of plastic records they used to get in like magazines?
No, it was like a McDonald's. Player. It was a McDonald's contest where you would play. It came in the for us, it was called the Virginia Pilot newspaper. And it was like this little, it was a record, but it was like plastic flimsy, and you'll put it down, play it. And so I have this song, like, and it was basically a song of all the things on the McDonald's menu. And then at the end, it would tell you if you won $1 million or not. Yeah. I did not. Much like the many Monopoly pieces that you have, all of them except one. I never won anything. I did get a lot of free fries, though.
Yes, I remember getting a lot of free French fries and hash browns.
But how to listen to this whole tape and then find out if you won $1 million. So, like, Big Mac Jr., you lost. Big Mac, chicken nugget.
Quarter pounder with some cheese, filet of fish, hamburger, cheeseburger, Happy Meal. Well,
there's a big. we're digressing way too much now.
But having said that,
come back.
Yes. But having said that, Ollie, I want to say thank you so much for joining us. Thank you for providing our information. We've added it to Slack. See,
I remember that.
I'll remember it.
Yeah, and thank you, Ollie.
We thank you for joining us. Thanks for answering these crazy questions. Thank you so much.
Your insight is going to be very valuable to these students while they're building these sites and portals. So thank you so much.
Yes. And having said that, Ollie, we welcome you to stay on with us for a few moments so that we can actually display our team goals. Now, Ollie, I want to tell you ahead of time that the team goals, each team has one slide that they're going to present, and they have 1 minute to present it. And we have three teams, so this should be quick.
Okay, sure.
All right. Now, having said that, what I'm going to do here is I'm going to go ahead and pull up my slides again, and I'm also going to hide the film strip, there we go, so that we can all be surprised, even though we've all seen it, at our teams. Now, let me make sure I share sound, because we have made some adjustments. Now let me move this over and make this larger. All right. Now, Ollie, I'm gonna let you know right now, if you wouldn't mind, if you're able to stay for a few minutes, if there are any considerations that you see for their team goals as they're designing their portals and things, that you, if you see any bottlenecks or something and you're like, hey, you may want to be aware of such and such, please feel free to add after their presentation. Of course, I'm saying this to all of our organizers and mentors as well. And again, we are a family, so we're here to support each other. So if there's anything that we can see that we may be able to help out with, we do want to add that in. Okay. So with that, thank you. So with that, without further ado, we'd like to welcome our first team, the Bug Busters. The Bug Busters, the floor is yours.
Hello. We, the Bug Busters, have come up with 5 goals that we wanted to accomplish this week. The first being, we wanted to find our target audience for the new Hack HPC website. Second, we wanted to include informative content about what a hackathon is, how to register, what events that have happened in the past, what will be coming up, who are the staff, what are the rules, and how to contact. So we also wanted to improve navigation by including a search bar, header, and footer. And we also wanted to link information between both of the old websites. Lastly, we wanted to update the aesthetics by adding images from most recent events and creating a thematically concise UI and organizing content. That is our 5 goals.
Excellent, wonderful, and good timing as well. Good job, Sierra. Thank you so much. I am going to add that what I would suggest, you all have a fantastic list of goals that I am very excited about seeing. I would suggest, and I'm going to actually suggest this for all the teams if you haven't, for each of your goals / tasks, assign someone on your team to be the lead for that particular task. That doesn't mean they have to get that task accomplished, but what that means is they're the go-to person, that they're in charge of that particular task. So if they're able to code it up themselves, great. If they're the one that is just making sure different components come together, great. But put somebody in charge of things. That way they have ownership over them. And big tip, share it out. Don't just put one person. Like Sierra's doing 1, 2, 3, and 4, you know, and somebody else is doing 1. Yeah, you don't want to do that. Share them out.
And also whoever's leading it, think about that leader as kind of like the project manager. You know, they're essentially getting other people involved in doing it. So the 5 of whoever's, how many people in your group? I think there's 5. The 5 people in your group?
6.
6, okay. So they're all essentially going to be working on multiple parts, and then each one of them will also be the lead on another part. That is a very, when you have a team and everybody's kind of on the same level, that's how you kind of build these items out. So yeah, great, great point there, Danny.
Excellent. All right.
Before you put it, your final version of this up, your second bullet is, you have a lot of run-on sentences, little phrases in there, but the one that I think needs improving along with the punctuation best is, what have events have been and will be had? So you're actually, I think, trying to say there, what are the past events, the current events, and future events, upcoming events. Past, current, and upcoming events is the way I would suggest you phrase that.
Thank you.
Okay.
Excellent job. Excellent job.
Yeah, great job, team.
Any other questions, concerns? All right. Because you all are coding, I would go ahead. A lot of times teams wait to do their GitHub repos in the end. This goes for all the teams. I suggest you all do your GitHub repos in the beginning. That's one of your deliverables, so that you all have a shared space where your code is located. So that not one person has the sole control over the code base. This is going to be something that's interesting during collaborative coding, but it's worthwhile to put in that effort up front Branches. Branches are your friend. Branches are your friend. Up next. No. There we go. We would like to welcome to the stage our code warrior.
I'll smile on what it takes to fool this town. I'll do it till the sun goes down and all through the night time.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, I hear that.
Uh-oh.
Silence.
All right, Anthony's. I see Anthony's there. Oh, there we go. Oh, he's logging in.
Yeah.
Uh-oh. Do we have someone else from the Code Warriors that is able to present that can back Anthony up? Remember, we're family. We're here to help each other. Oh, I think your internet's kind of like my internet. There's this one special part of the day where the internet decides to be, let's say, unfriendly. All right.
Hello, everyone.
Oh, there we go. All right. So let me now. Okay. I can hear you. What I'm going to do is I'm going to back up a little bit because we're doing this for the recording. Then make sure, are you still there?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to back up to the previous slide. I'm going to introduce you one more time so that you can go ahead and start. That sound good?
Okay.
All right. Here we go. Oh no, not in that window. This window. Okay. Here we go. So now I'd like to welcome to give their team goals, the Code Warriors.
I'll smile on what it takes to fool this Warriors. Down. I'll do it to
hello,
the
Warriors. My name is Daniela. I'm from Code Warriors, and these are our goals. The first one is to research the best way to incorporate videos into the website or the web page. And the second one is to develop an FAQ that answers basic questions about ADME. Third one is to implement member login and profile features. Then the fourth one is to create a feedback page, which I think is very important. Then the fifth one is to create a blog page. These are all our goals. I look forward to your suggestion. Thank you very much.
Excellent.
Love that. And
I just want to say, I love the fact that not only did you put days, but you put times along with them to say when you want these accomplished. Of course I do. So I love that.
I'm gonna do. You know, the other thing I really like, Jamie, that they have the goal, a feedback page.
Yes.
Love that idea.
Now, so the best way to incorporate video, I've been a part of ADME for many years. Mm-hmm. I didn't know that ADME had videos. So.
We were thinking of putting in, like making the videos or pictures or past Code Warriors, the goals and stuff like that to make a video. And then just put it up so that people coming to the website can know what all this is about and what we're expecting to do. Okay.
That is fantastic. I'm looking forward to that. So you all may, of course, I do want to put a hint out there for you. I'm not sure if ADME has this. I've never looked. I never thought about it. If ADME has a YouTube presence, so you can actually add those videos to YouTube and then you can easily embed them into the site in what are called iframe tags. Actually, YouTube gives them to you for free, which are awesome. I think that would be a good way to do that, but I'd like to add one more thing to your list of tasks. And this is a very selfish one. And if the other team, because we do have a second team that's working on ADME USA, on the Admin USA portal is a photo gallery.
Uh-huh.
We at Admin take pictures like crazy. We do that to document the different events, to show the true faces of the members that are there. And am I missing any other reason, Doc, that we do that?
Yeah, just to document the experience, the highlights. But I'm going to give her, I'm going to put in chat a link to our photo resources. It's on Nia. And it has photos from Admin to go back to the 1990s. So you might photo library for Admin. Well, for all of our events. But once you get in there, you will want to just search for Admin. And it will show you, you know, Admin sites, photo images for many, 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 many years. And you'll have a good time putting together a highlight reel from using these images.
I just want to say, if you see a picture in there of me with hair, don't be shocked.
I don't know if it goes back that far.
Oh, Doc. Oh, my soul.
Like, when was the last time you had hair, Jamie?
It was a while. It was a while. That.
So you walked right in the 2000s. Right in and took it.
Dr. Hayden.
You're getting hostile.
Dr. Hayden won. Jamie, zero.
And 20-06. No, we can't.
No.
No. No. That is fantastic. And of course, again, same thing. Of course, I would suggest you identify people that are going to be in charge of each section. And make use of Slack. That's what it's there for. Use Slack. That is a very powerful tool for you all to be able to communicate, even when we're not in these Zoom sessions. Lanesha.
The link doesn't work.
The what one link? I put in there?
The one you put in there.
Okay, so it's nia.ecsu.edu photo index.
Just get rid of the last slash.
And it worked, boy.
Yeah. Okay. Just when you go to click on it, just go up into your browser and hit backspace over that last slash and then you'll get it.
That worked. Thank you.
Okay. Now when you go in there, you know, you could hit Control F, find, and type in Admin, you'll see at least 20 photo indexes there, photo libraries of past Admin events. Have fun.
All right. Excellent job. Excellent job. And let's move on to our final team. Why do you do this to me, Google? There we go. Our final team. The data miners. Data miners. The floor is yours.
Hello, everyone. Data miners are on the stage. So here are our team goals. First of all, we are going to create foundational website since we are planning to create new website for Admin from zero. And Devon is going to be responsible for that. Make about us page. I am going to be responsible for that. This is our second goal. And third, we are going to create a new resource page. And Colin is going to do it. Create a working newsletter data report. Lanesha is responsible for that part. Yes, that's cool. And we are going to create a blog. And who is we? We is Javid. So he's going to do that. And here are our five goals. Oh, I forgot putting our music on back end. I forgot.
No, it's okay.
You got too excited. It's yeah. Okay.
Excellent job. Excellent job. Of course, I love how you all have those connected with who's going to do what. Now, I do want to say something, though. Now, of course, your two teams came from one very large group that are all working on Abbey USA. As you see, some of your goals kind of overlap. So for instance, I know for a fact the blog is one that kind of overlaps. I was wondering, between the two teams, so between the data miners and the code warriors, are you all going to connect in any way to make sure that you all don't do double duty?
May I ask a question before that?
Sure.
So about the blog, is there a way to clarify the blog part that First Team is going to do? Because we're trying to, I don't know how illusional it sounds, we're trying to create a website that will generate a template, as if admin goes to a website and, you know, creates a post, like you're gonna put your pictures and description and you know, more details, and it will just generate and create a web page for that.
Yes it does. You want to see an example? Well, it doesn't matter if you want to or not, I'm going to show you. So we're going to so let me, oops, no, don't go there.
Not that's that. Our song.
That is your song. But let's go to the site that I'm not going to allow Ali to tear apart. We're going to, all right, so this is the, of course, this is the event site right now. Now, what you see here are actually posts, so it is a blog. And when I click in it, of course, it goes in. And for instance, these were the two pitch slides. But if I back up, code of conduct's there. But I'll show you the one that I'm working on. This looks terrible right now. I'm going to tell you right now, this looks bad because I'm still working on it. Or better yet, I'll go to schedule. That's what I'll do because I'm a smart person. So inside of schedule, you see these different sections that are all kind of recreations of themselves, but of course they have very specific information for the particular day. Well, let me check the code real quick. So I'm gonna switch over to VS Code here. And this is actually on the GitHub repository, but I have it local right now. So you get to see that I was adding the links that Ali and Charlie were offering things, but I'm actually gonna go to this little file here called schedule. And schedule is a YAML file, yet another markup language.
Hey, Jamie, before we dive too far into this, was this auto-generated by Drop, or did you write all this yourself?
So I cheated. I straight up cheated. I'm not a programmer. I'm a systems administrator that happens to be able to code. So I pulled down a Jekyll theme, and that information went over during the overview. I went to jekyllthemes.org, picked the theme that I liked, and then I started modifying it. Now this schedule.yaml file, if you look up here, it says general schedule, date June 26, 2023 at 10:30 a.m. And that little -4 means that it's in the Eastern time zone. Yes, I will. I will post it to chat. Over here on the right, if you notice here, Thursday, June 20, oh, because I went down, general session. There we go. Monday, June 26, morning session. It has the information in there that 10:30 a.m., all this is auto-generated from that. Oh, I'm pointing to it as if you can see it. So if I switch back over to the site, there we go, right there. All that information is actually being generated here. Monday, June 26th, it's the morning session. It's called the Hackathon Kickoff. It has the time there. It has the slide deck. All of that is auto-generated from a config file. The other side of that, to answer Javid's question, even going back to the home where we have the posts here that are showing up. If I switch back to my code, I am doing a lot of code switching here. If I switch back to my code, over here on the left, see how this section called posts? And I click on the file. I added information here, but it still generates the site itself on its own. So this part is really easy. But then all the formatting, the CSS and all that is just a duplicate of one another as it goes through. So I'm saying that to say this. Mm-hmm. Yes, there are ways to template things. And yes, it can make your life a lot easier. Now, Boyd also knows a couple other programs. Like Boyd actually uses Hugo a lot. Ali, is there one that you use a lot? Or used to use a lot?
Similar to that?
Yes.
Static site generator.
No. I just use GitHub Pages usually.
Yep. And that's exactly, so the Jekyll themes, that's exactly what GitHub Pages is. It's using the Jekyll code on top of or inside of Git Pages. It actually renders it out for you. Matter of fact, this yet another theme right here, this yet, I know it's small, let me make it a little bit bigger. This right here, that is actually what the website is. This is the, so if I go to the homepage, no, I don't want to go to the homepage of it, that's their code. But if I go to demo, when you look at it, some of the elements look familiar. I just modified the configuration files. If I slap the add me picture right there, background there, and change the post names, you'd see it's the same exact site. I'm not reinventing the wheel. I'm using something that's already there. And what I'll do here is this is in the resources. Wait, I've learned my lesson. I'm going to drop this in chat, but I'm also going to put this in, let me go to everyone in meeting. Yes, there we go. And Doc, of course, showed us the one from the faculty hack. I'll go to that in a minute here, Doc, as well. But if I go here, that's exactly what it is. But when I say under resources, if you go to resources up top in our page, so all the schedules, things that show up here are from the sessions are there, and all the different links are there. Ali, I know. I'm going to break it up, Ali. I promise you I will break this up a little bit better. But the Jekyll themes are here, serving it locally. Different snippets to be able to help you out are in there listed inside of resources. And from Doc, she wanted me to show
me. Let me just say, and this is different from where the direction you were leading in, but both of them have a blog. Both of the two teams working on the AdMe site have a blog. We don't need two efforts going in that direction. One of our major thrusts with the AdMe website was to add a resource for faculty that included curriculum and resources, that, like the ones that were generated out of our faculty hackathon. They are available on this site. And what one of those two teams needs to focus on bringing these faculty resource to our AdMe site. So, so one of those two teams.
I was just gonna say that was part of our resources page. We just put resources page to like sum it up, but there was like a student and a faculty resources page.
All right.
So if it was possible, could the Code Warriors do the photo gallery and we continue with the resources?
Sure. That's fine with me as long as it gets done.
Okay.
Lanisha's got a question as well.
Oh, that was Lanisha.
Oh, I thought that was Shortcut. Yeah, sorry.
Not a problem. All right.
Everything's moving around.
So there are things out there. We'll be glad to help you out. Maybe take a few minutes after, you know, our all together session and consider some of those adjustments to see if it can help you out. you don't have to write. If there is anyone here that's thinking they need to write all this stuff from scratch, let me clarify that right now and tell you, no, you do not have to do this from scratch. You should be taking something that's available and modifying it as needed. Don't try to reinvent the wheel.
Yeah, sorry, Jamie. To clarify that, one of the key things of programming is never reinventing the wheel. There are lots of sample codes out there. For example, there are galleries, image carousels, things like that, that can help you without you having to program it itself. Just take the piece and add that to your code. So a lot of you groups that have your goals looked out, Google on those goals and see what comes up and see who has done what. Make sure you're not making the same mistakes that other people have, which is why they post some of that stuff. Go to Stack Overflow and see what kind of issues people have had trying to develop something that you've done, and learn from the experience of others. And yeah, don't reinvent the wheel. Look to see what's out there.
And I'll also throw out there that in searching Google for these different things, some of the things we tell our students when we're teaching programming is we're not there to make you an expert. We're there to teach you to be intelligent Googlers.
Important thing.
It's to make, so in other words, making good use of your resources in this case would be, I want an image gallery. So we're saying photo gallery. That's synonymous with image gallery, photo carousel. All those things kind of line up to mean the same thing. And sometimes I'll give you one more tip for myself. There are times that I can read through somebody's text and I don't get it. I will go on YouTube in a minute and watch a quick tutorial to watch somebody else do it so that then I can come back and duplicate it. So don't be scared to do that as well. Okay. All right. Having said that, I want to say thank you to Ali again for his very deep insights into UI and UX. Thank you for your time and joining us. Thank you to the teams for giving us their goals. We look forward to all the things you're going to do. We're going to open up the breakout rooms here in a moment, but first we're going to stop the recording. Oh, we have one more thing from Dr. Hayden. Doc, go ahead.
Ali has agreed to join us as a judge on Thursday.
This
is for a special award that we're going to be giving out, and we're going to be looking at the team that has the best use of the four rules for intuitive UX. The team that has the best use of the four rules for intuitive UX.
So I
hope the teams were paying attention during that talk.
It's almost like that link that we put in Slack that has those four rules might be important.
Yep.
Now I want to say this one more time. So Doc, while you're there, we're having an adjustment to the awards we're going to give. So we're going to have, so Doc, would you mind stating those just so that everyone's aware of those awards?
Yes. Now we will have a Judge's Choice Award, and several people have agreed to work with us as judges. You'll meet them on Thursday, but some of them are familiar faces, one or two may be new to you. So there will be a Viewer's Choice, there will be a Judge's Choice Award. And the Judge's Choice Award has a lot, do you want me to go over all those characters?
No. They have the video. It is available.
Okay. And we will have a UX award. That's the one that Ali's going to be working with us to select. The UX award team that does have the best use of the four rules for intuitive UX will receive a $100.
Ooh.
Got interesting.
Excellent. All so right. That's the, is that the S? Is that the SGX3 UI award?
Exactly.
Excellent. See, I'm writing them down, Doc. Make sure we're right. All right. And I think we're going to say, as far as in viewer's choice, because we only have three teams, that's rough. So we're not going to do a viewer's choice. So we're going to have two awards out there, the judge's choice and the SGX3 UX UI award.
And that's the award that will have the $100 per team.
Same rules apply, is a team can't win all awards? Or do you want to talk about that later? We can talk about that later.
Yeah, we do need to talk about that.
Yes. All right. Well, thank you, Dr. Hayden. We do appreciate it. Having said that, I'm going to end our recording and we're going to open up the breakout room so our teams can get to work. And we will see you again in a few hours at our afternoon session where we want to hear your progress. All right. Take care.
Awesome. Happy hacking. You.